Welcome, and well, I say good morning, I think. And I'm Vittorio Saggiomo. So I'm an assistant professor in the laboratory of BioNanoTechnology, and this is the sensor and device course. First of all, why we are here? We are here because it's October. I still have to get the schedule for my course, and moreover, the infection of the coronavirus are going through the roof.
Winter is coming.
This means that they can change the regals, they can change the rules day after day. So today we can decide, okay, we are going to do in the campus. Tomorrow is everything in lockdown again. So I have to make a call, and the call that will be this year, the course will be done in a different way. So we will have recorded lectures like this one. We will have live lecture. Most of the experiment we will try to do it at home. If we have the possibility, we will do it also at university, because there is something that we cannot do at home, but most of it will be done at home. So you can do the experiment directly at home. Then every single Friday we will have a discussion about the lecture, about the experiments that you are doing at home, about some question that I will ask during the lectures, and also a discussion on how things are going at home. So is your experiment working? Is not working? Why? And so on. We will also have a literature discussion on Friday. So you will also read a literature and you come up with a title or an explanation on how that research works. So as I said, this is the second part of the minor in biotechnology. You have seen the introduction, previous period, and the next period you will do some nanomedicine. And if you take a look about our logo, you can see that all these three parts are in the logo itself. So you have an introduction, which is mostly on nanoparticles, then the sensor and device is mostly on the technology part, while the following course, the nanomedicine, is going to be on, well, nanomedicine and biology. Before we start, I want to give you a little test. So pick up a pen and a paper and just follow this simple instruction. Draw this kind of square with four squares inside, and then pick up the first square, and you should divide the white part in two equal parts. That should be pretty straightforward, and this should be the answer. Those are two equal parts. If you go in the next square, now I'm asking you, okay, divide the white part in three equal parts. Also, this should be pretty straightforward, and this is how it should look like. Now I'm going to the next square and say, okay, now you should divide this one in four equal parts. And things are getting interesting, a little bit more difficult. So, can you do it? Maybe, maybe not. If I say, okay, pick up the white part and just draw exactly the same white part, but it's smaller size, and then you can fill practically every single cube or every single square that you want. So when you have such things to design, you just make it smaller and then try to fit it everything together. Now for the last question is pick up the last square that we have left and divide this one in seven equal parts. And you should be able to do this in less than 1 minute. I'm not counting.
Eventually.
Okay. Maybe you are done. Well, on Friday you will tell me if you are done or not. And if you are done, well done, first of all. And the second thing that I want to teach you with this exercise is do not let teacher close you in a box. So if I'm teaching a method, doesn't mean that this method is good for everything. You should always come up with your own ideas, and you should always try to challenge me, because it's not that I'm always right just because I'm a teacher. I can be wrong. Science can be wrong. So try to think critically about the exercise or the experiment that you're doing, and try to be critical and challenge me, because it's science. You can be right, you can be wrong, but you should be critical about what are you doing. That was the first part, and the second part, and on the similar exercise, sometimes I found something very weird on Twitter, and I discovered that they are measuring yields just by picking up one by one, anesthetize them, and then just physically measure them. And my stupid question was, okay, why you are just not taking a picture of it, and then using software you can measure it? And this is not coming up from I don't know where in my mind, but it's because we are doing actually the same with DNA or with practically any other microscopy technique that we use. So we can measure things just by taking a picture of it. And that's the second point of this course. Use the knowledge that you acquire in this course for everything else. So it's not that the knowledge that you're acquiring during this course, it's only for this course and then you can forget everything. We are going to see a lot of different things that can be applied in many different fields, so not only molecular life science or chemistry, but in many different fields, also for your bachelor, for your master, for your PhD, and so on. So use the knowledge for everything else. Now, let's go to the central part of this course, and it's what is a sensor? A sensor is an object, or let's say a chemical, if you're using a chemical sensor, which is able to detect an event or change and then report back what happened. So you have an output from that sensor. You can have a physical sensor or a chemical sensor. Okay, you know, if you are a physicist, everything is about physics and every single sensor is a physics sensor. I know that, but bear with me for a little bit. As a chemical sensor, I want to say that the change is at molecular level. In the chemical world, you are changing at molecular level what happened to the sensor. So you can have, for example, a molecule that change or reacts, and then you have a sensor. Most of the case, pH sensor works in this way. So you can have a protonation or deprotonation, and then the color change of the sensor. You can have a color change by complexation. So if I have a porphyrin, depending if there is iron inside or magnesium inside, they have different color. So one, for example, is the chlorophyll, and the other one is a hemigroup. So it's either red or green. And this is a sensor, because now I can use this molecule for sensing which ion is in one solution. Or they can change, the color can change, or the fluorescence can change by conformational changes. So if I have a fret pair, we will see later what are those fret pairs, but they change the color depending on the conformation. So if they are far away, they will have one fluorescent color. If they are together, they have another fluorescent color. And there are a lot of different chemicals that naturally can be used as a sensor. Then the next point is, what is a device? We saw that a chemical sensor or a physical sensor should give an output, but what is going to read this output? Can I read this output? And that's an important question. So if I show you this graph here and I ask you, okay, what is the difference? In few seconds, you should say, okay, the difference is the color. So those three bars have three different colors. Well done. So it means that your brain is the detector. Your brain process what's happening. So your eyes see the different color and then your brain saying, okay, those are different colors. If I'm showing this other graph and say, okay, what is the difference between those three bars? That's a little bit more complicated, a little bit more complex. You may say it's the size, but the size is the same. It's the distance is the same. Also in this case, actually, the different thing is the color. So they have a very small difference in color. If I use a computer, I can detect this change. So if I use a computer, I can see the change. If I use my brain and my eyes, I cannot. So it means that this is actually below the limit of detection. So I cannot see this threshold. And this is exactly the same things that happened a few years ago with this dress. Someone sees black and blue, some other people sees what was gold and white. The color is always the same. The color doesn't change. Your eyes also don't change, but it's how you process the picture that you're seeing, this is what changed. So your detector, your brain, is actually playing some tricks. Because if I go to the computer, on a computer, and I can see, okay, which color is this one, that's the color, that's it. I cannot see anything else. But your brain is making a difference, saying, okay, this is blue or this is gold. There are many different ways on how you can trick your brain. This is, for example, another one. You see those spheres, they look a different color, but actually they are exactly the same color. And that's another time in which you see a color, but then your device, your brain, processes in another way. I leave you this one to you. So what is, can you see something different here? And also this one to you. That will be in the slide, so you can take a look deeply at those pictures for a long time. And then on Friday, we will try to figure out what happened in those pictures. Now, we have seen, I can literally say, okay, those are my senses, and this is why they're called sensor, and this is why they're called senses, and this is why they're called sensors. My five sense, unless you have a sixth sense.
I want to tell you my secret now.
Those one are my sensors, and then my device is my brain. So I can use my senses, and then I bring everything to my brain. We have seen the limit of detection of my eyes, between my eyes and my brain, but we can also do the same things with smell. So for example, if I have a benzaldehyde in the lab and I can smell the benzaldehyde, usually it smells like almonds. So as an Italian, I think, okay, those are really sweet almonds and I want to eat them, but the almond also smells like cyanide. And cyanide is quite toxic. So if you are in a lab and you smell almond, in most of the cases, it's not benzaldehyde, but it's cyanide. And that's quite dangerous. And differentiate though, so is the smell of the benzaldehyde or is the smell of cyanide? This is the accuracy of my sensor. So can I discriminate two things? Is my sensor good enough to discriminate both? That's the accuracy of the sensor. So we have seen limit of detection and accuracy of the sensor. Why are sensors so important? We have sensors practically everywhere. Why? They are so important because this is actually our interface to the world. So we have five or six senses, but we want to have more. So if I put my hands near hot water, I know that it's hot, but I don't know how hot it is. If I want to see how much light is, I know that there is some light. I don't know how much light is in this room, for example. There are a lot of sensors that are just the way how we perceive the world. So from the biggest telescope on Earth to the smallest molecule that goes inside your cell and can detect a disease, for example, all of those are how we perceive the world. Another very important thing is that we can understand very complex systems. So the more the sensor, the more the data you can get out of a sensor, out of a complex system. And hypothetically, if we are good enough and we have a mathematical model for it, we can even make a prediction of, for example, global temperature, but also earthquakes and so on. So we need a lot of data, we need a lot of sensor, and we need also a good mathematical model for making a prediction, which I hope is going to be possible. During this first introduction, I also say, okay, those sensors are also extremely important for disease and health. So those sensors can be really useful for a fast response. And I always make a case of the 1918 Spanish flu, which killed 50 million people. 50 million people, it's actually more than the Netherlands itself. So think about just wiping Netherlands and Belgium from Earth. That's how bad this disease was. And I try to analyze how did it happen? So what happened there that we end up with 50 million dead? And there were multiple reasons. So one of these was scientific. So it was very late for the diagnostic, so they really realized really late that this was not a normal flu, but was something else. Because there was the war going on, there was a lack of communication. It's actually called the Spanish flu, not because it started in Spain, but is because Spain was the first one to report it, because they didn't have a lack of communication, or there was no war there. They were free to say, okay, this is something else than a normal flu. It was highly infective, and there were really low hygiene, and that's also because the war was going on. And unfortunately, the penicillin was discovered 10 years later. Yes, I know that this one was a virus and the penicillin is an antibiotic, but you had a lot of diseases after the viruses. And those one were bacteria infection. So the penicillin would have helped. And it's the fifth or maybe the sixth year I'm giving this course. And I always end up with the conclusion, okay, can it happen again today? Yes, it may in some region of the world, and actually it did, for example, with Ebola or the Zika virus, because you have a really late response. So when you have a late response, it means that you are already in the exponential growth of the epidemic, and then practically you're done. The missed opportunity is as early as the virus appears, because you should start quarantine as soon as possible, and then you practically break the virus diffusion. Unfortunately, it's 2020. This is happening again. I thought I would leave something like this, but apparently I was wrong. And I was wrong because I was mostly thinking about scientific point of view. So on the scientific point of view, nowadays, after 8 months, we know a lot about this virus. After a few weeks, we already had a PCR that could check who was infected and who was not. And on the scientific side, is should be quite straightforward. The only things you need to do is limit the contacts and wearing a mask. In this case, you don't have that many cases. If you don't have that many cases, you can start testing a lot of people and do the contact tracing. So if someone is infected, you need to check the previous day, the previous days who this person was in contact with, and then you start quarantine also the other people. This is possible if you have 100 cases. This is literally impossible if you have 5,000 cases per day, because you cannot do contact tracing on 5,000 people. But if you follow all of those guidelines, it should be quite straightforward to stop the virus. And this is exactly what the World Health Organization was saying many, many months ago.
But the most effective way to prevent infections and save lives is breaking the chains of transmission. And to do that, you must test and isolate. You cannot fight a fire blindfolded, and we cannot stop this pandemic if we don't know who is infected. We have a simple message for all countries: test, test, test.
So limit the contact, wear a mask so you have not that many cases, you should testing, and you should do quarantine as soon as possible. I was not thinking about the political side of it and the economical side, and this is my washing machine. That's another sensor, actually. So he knows that it knows that it finished. Should stop soon, maybe.
A little longer than a few minutes later.
It will never stop. Yeah, okay, it stopped. Well done. So, I was not thinking about the political side and the economical side of it. And this is something I was only thinking about the scientific problem, not about the rest of the problem. And the political side during this pandemic has been, let's say, not the best. Let's put it in this way.
The CDC is advising the use of non-medical cloth face covering as an additional voluntary public health measure. So it's voluntary. You don't have to do it. They suggest it for a period of time. But this is voluntary. I don't think I'm going to be doing it.
Pelo meu histórico de atleta, caso fosse contaminado pelo vírus, não precisaria me preocupar. Nada sentiria ou seria, quando muito, acometido de uma gripezinha ou resfriadinho.
I'm shaking hands continuously. I was at a hospital the other night where I think there were actually a few coronavirus patients, and I shook hands with everybody. You'll be pleased to know, and I continue to shake hands, and I think it's very important that we, you know, people obviously can make up their own minds. I think that Matt has said that people must make up their own minds, but I think the scientific evidence is, well, I'll hand over to the experts, but our judgment is washing your hands is the crucial thing.
Actually, all those people won the Ig Nobel Prize for medicine for using the COVID viral pandemic to teach the world that politicians have a more immediate effect on life and death than scientists and doctors. This is quite sad. And the other things I didn't think about were all these so-called hashtag COVIDiots. People that don't believe in science, don't believe in masks, don't believe in vaccination, don't believe practically in anything scientific.
When you wear a mask, which you can certainly do, you are further pushing the agenda that is condemning all of us.
Aan het eind van de middag staan er nog ongeveer 200 mensen. Die sluiten hun coronaprotest af met een grote groepsknuffel.
I will leave you with this beautiful sentence from the Minister of Health in the Netherlands. We are doing our best, but the virus is doing better. And see you in the next video.